Hello, welcome to my channel. So, I wanted to do something special for Halloween this year. Not that it's the most original idea in the world, but I did this cobweb or spiderweb generator for ZBrush. I really didn't do any research before I started, and maybe I should have, because there is this awesome add-on for Blender that uses the built-in cloth modifier and looks really cool. Oh well, since this plugin is for ZBrush and I was almost done by the time I found that tool in Gumroad, I decided to go ahead and finish it anyway. I will leave the Blender add-on link in the description. First thing I'm going to do is click on the Precompute Distance Field button. This is just a pretentious way to tell the program, hey, this is the reference mesh I want to create cobwebs on. Once the distance field is stored in disk, you can use the Web on Mesh from Distance Field button. Yes, that's the awful name I gave it, but I made icons so we can forget about it. The web threads slider determines the number of cobweb threads. The web tension slider, well, is quite self-explanatory. The lower the tension, the more exaggerated the hanging curve is going to be. Notice how it creates a new subtool based on the mesh precomputed distance field, the base subtool in my example. I'm going to delete them, create new ones with less tension. And you can see they have less tension now. Let's create some more again. Okay. So it doesn't matter which subtool is currently selected and active, this button will simply add a new subtool based on the distance field. Let's delete this mess. Minimum maximum distance slider. Well, let's see how I can explain this. Okay, they are just like filters. Threads connecting two points on the base mesh that are closer than the minimum distance and farther away than the maximum distance won't get generated. So it doesn't matter how much you try these two spikes won't get cobwebs to connect them, okay? So, if I use the transpose line measure to measure the distance between them, it's about 0.3918, or exactly 0.3918. Okay. So, I can now go ahead and change the maximum distance value to something bigger than that 0.4. Like that, I'm going to filter the really tiny threads, increasing the minimum value as well. And now I should get threads connecting those two tentacles over there they're supposed to be. Tentacles. Similar to the maximum and minimum sliders, the constraints to normal function acts like a filter. With this constraint, a cobweb line will only be generated if the normals between the two points are facing each other. If I use the transpose line and click anywhere on the mesh, I can visualize the normal at that point. You can see that with a high constraint value, I won't be able to point, and only a few threads are generated. The ones from points with facing normals, the rest are filtered. If I set the constraint value to 0, there won't be any filters by normals and a lot more threads will be created. So in reality, web thread slider is never the actual number of threads but the number of attempts to create threads. I feel I'm over explaining something simple and making it look complicated when it really isn't. So okay, let's move on. Next couple of buttons might seem very similar to the previous one, but internally they are very different. Main difference is they don't work on a distance field, so you don't need to precompute. They generate the cobweb on selected subtool. The first one is the web on mesh. This button will generate cobwebs on the mesh as the previous one, but it doesn't need precompute the base mesh. It works on the subtool that is currently selected. The second one is called web on web. And it's also similar to the web on mesh, and it will work on any mesh, but it's optimized to work better on other web meshes. The same slider for tension, maximum, minimum, and normal constraint works in these buttons. Main thing to remember is these two buttons will always use the selected subtools as a reference. So if I use the first one again and click several times, I create a website always on the base subtool. But if I wanted to do the same thing with the web mesh, I will need to select the base subtool every time. So you get the idea. Okay, next function is transpose web. And as you can imagine, it connects two extremes of a transpose line with a catenary curve. You can adjust the thread tension with its own slider. And the transpose segment length slider controls the catenary curve step's resolution. The smaller the segment, the more loops will be generated. That simple. This one took me a long time to figure out. I wanted to create an Orb Weaver style web on the mesh, and this wasn't easy. It was hard to code, but it should be easy to use. The idea is placing the transpose line, clicking anywhere on the mesh. This line will define the plane in which the weaver will be built. So you just need to place the transpose line and click. I said you can click anywhere on the mesh. Obviously, the weaver needs a frame and anchor point to build on. So it won't work on convex surfaces. Frame thread line art controls the curvature of the outer ring of the spider web. It affects the curvature by controlling the tension of the frame threads towards the center node. The center node radius determines the width of the central node. This circle will be the origin of the radial thread and the spiral thread. Now it is wider here in the center, as you can see. Transpose distance slider determines the distance from the transpose origin. So let's see how I can explain this better. Let me see the transpose line. This is a good angle. If I create the spider web with a value of 100 distance, I get this. Let's increase it to about 200 and I get this. And a bit farther away, a bit farther away, and I get this. You get the idea. Let's delete this. Radial tension affects the tension of the radial threads. This should always have a high value. I'm going to increase the frame thread arc just a little bit so you can see how the curve is more. A little bit. You can see the curve towards the center is more evident now. So, pretty cool. What else do we have here? If I reduce the radial line spacing, I will get more radial threads. Right? You can see more radial threads there, the outer rim. And you won't be surprised, if I increase the spacing, I will get less radial threads. The connecting thread slider controls the number of these little webs connecting consecutive radial threads. You can see them. And it also had its own slider to control the tension of these threads. Make a spiral could also be a switch, and zero means no central spiral will be generated. So, and one means it will be generated. Right now I'm gonna make one without spiral and more connecting threads. So with a few clicks, I can create many web subtools and make a little bit of a mess. The merge web subtool will merge consecutive web subtools. So this can be handy if you have a lot of them. And now they're merged. Let's delete that. Create new ones. So web render settings will apply some specific render settings to the web subtools or any tool named web. It will apply a negative inflate deformation, set the subtool visibility as transparent, and fill it with a hair material. So if I go to deformation, smoothing the web subtool will make threads even thinner. This is better than inflate with a negative value in most cases, but it can slightly change the placement of loops, especially if the web subtool has been optimized with deleted edge loops. And well. Thank you for watching.